I have this IBM PC 5150 in my possession since half a year. Countless hours have gone into restoring this machine. I dealt with mice poop, short circuits, missing components, and broken stuff. Lots of broken stuff. But before this restored beauty finally moves into my museum, let's have a look at the final keyboard and floppy drive restoration steps. Retro computing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. If you were following my 5150 restoration journey, then you're aware that the second Tandon floppy drive that I had bought to install into that machine was also exposing some issues, even after re-lubricating the mechanics. So I used the image disk utility to check the alignment of the drive.
Hold it, wait a sec. Haven't you just been doing that on that other video already?
Yes, in fact I did. But if you had waited instead of just bluntly interrupting me, I would have told exactly that. Now go away! So, as I was going to say, my recent video about the Kaypro II machine, I was going down the route of removing and disassembling the stepper motor. The two floppy drives in question are very similar, as the one in the Kaypro II is the single-sided TM-100-1, and this one of the IBM PC is the TM-100-2, which is a double-sided drive. The procedure is the same though, and is exactly what I'm going to do here, as this drive is totally out of alignment, seeing reads of actual tracks 8, 18 and 28 for the tracks 10, 20 and 30 respectively. It is even that worse that when starting on track 0, I have to step through track 4 until image disk thinks it's actually reading off track 1. So this is definitely an issue with the stepper, so stripping down it is. Again, I'll disassemble the entire stepper motor and remove the ball bearings to soak them in WD-40 and then after in lubricant. Well, these bearings are not in that worse conditions as the ones found in the TM-100-1 drive, but have some resistance as well. So this treatment is definitely no wrong here. And after reassembling everything, I give it another shot in image disk. Finding the sweet spot was a bit more cumbersome this time, and I realized what I had forgotten to tell in the other video. This screw here, which fixates the head carriage to the stepper axis, must be very carefully adjusted, whereas not being too tight. If you have it too tight, the stepper will lock up and the carriage won't move. And you have it too loose, the axis will slip and you will constantly get out of alignment again. So try finding the sweet spot of how tight the screw must be. But eventually, it was good, clocking in at 18 successful reads and no further read errors. From this point onwards, I was then able again to format disks in that drive without any complaints whatsoever about inabilities to write track 0. Also, the floppies became interchangeable and fully readable and writable between the drives, telling me this operation was successful at last. So finally the time to reassemble not only the drive, but also mount it back into the drive bay. It's been a good while that the machine was sitting around more or less in pieces, and now finally the case is closed again for the first time in 6 months. That leaves me now for the final part, fixing the Model F83 Keys keyboard. As shown in a previous video, I had already gone down to disassemble it and fix various broken parts. But on my first functional test, I noticed that some keys were not working.
Yeah, but why weren't you caring to fully fix it in the first place then?
Simple enough. I had no clue what happened and what to do about it in time enough before getting the video out. as I had seen already many times issues with defective leads or ICs, I expected the worst here for the Model F keyboard, so I had to first find some time to read up what's wrong here.
Then you should document that.
That's what this video is about. Now get lost already. Well, the fix for the non-working keys is that outright simple that it's almost embarrassing already. The diagnostics is rather primitive, just showing a white square in place of the keys. The actual physical key will be shown only once you press it on the keyboard. It's archaic, but it gets the job done and eventually uncovers all malfunctioning keys. It turns out that the keys won't register if the buckling spring isn't neatly fitted under the keycap. So simply removing the keycap and reseating it should actually help. And so it does. It's totally amazing and far less fatalistic than what I had believed. After all, I could have fixed this weeks ago already. But I'm overly happy it was that simple in the end, as I would have definitely needed a large swearing jar if I had to disassemble this keyboard again. But now I can finally move the 5150 over to my little museum. And this concludes my restoration journey of the IBM PC 5150. It only took a mere 6 months since the release of the first video in March 2022 and a total of 11 installments to reach this final stage. But it was fully worth it, every single minute, to see this beautiful machine spinning again in all its glory. And as you can see, I already made a spare place beside it to fit the IBM PC XT 5160 as soon as I'm done fixing that machine up as well. Though my collection revolves around mobile computing, having an original PC and PC XT in the collection is the exception from the rule. This makes them the two most outstanding desktop computers in a total of 12 non-portable machines in my entire collection of almost 100 machines. Less to say, the ones that kicked off a whole generation of IBM PC compatibles. Oh, and look at this! Here's the IBM PC Portable 5155, which by bad luck now suddenly needs some maintenance on non-working floppy drives as well. It seems I'm not letting loose from fixing floppy drives, but that's definitely for another video. I hope you enjoyed not only this video, but my entire restoration journey. In case you missed it, you can catch up via the playlist shown right now. Don't forget to subscribe if you're up for future shenanigans. As always, thanks for watching and see you next time. You're about to see some potential upcoming topics for future videos right now. Please let me know in the comments which topics you are particularly interested in. Of course, you can also drop me in some other topics you'd like me to chase down.